Sean Sennett from Time Off Media joins me this afternoon. Hey, Sean.
Hey, Kelly. How are you going?
Good.
Great to have the boys in the studio.
Oh, isn't it, though? Oh, well, let's introduce them now, shall we? John Brewster, Dave Gleeson, how are you doing?
Oh, very well, thank you.
Great, thanks.
Excellent. No, it is now. It helps.
Oh, there we are.
I've only got the interns, apparently. When was the first time you saw the Angels?
Well, first time I saw the Angels would have been the late 80s. But I think, like a lot of kids in Brisbane, we used to listen to those wonderful simulcasts on a rival stereo station from Festival Hall. They play those shows all the time.
Yeah.
Those wonderful tapes. And I remember seeing some pub gig somewhere where you guys blew the roof off, your habit.
We used to do that. We still do that.
Roofs going off everywhere. I've seen these guys quite a lot in recent years. And, you know, with Dave out the front too, it's wonderful.
Oh, I saw you at A Day on the Green a couple of years back.
Yeah.
It was so much fun.
Yeah, they're great shows, they are. We love them.
Yeah.
And I can say the first time I ever saw the Angels was probably about 1986. My first band got to support the Angels at the Cessnock Supporters Club, I think, in the Hunter Valley, in the coal region of Hunter Valley. We were called at that stage. We were still just a Newcastle cover band at that stage. So we had to supply loaders in and out. And I remember at the end of the night, the crew said, "Well, I'll see you later, boys." It was like 2 o'clock in the morning. We're like, "Are you going back to Newcastle?" And they're like, "No, we're going north." And we were like, "Okay." We were still in high school. We had to go to school the next day. Our guitarist mum came and picked us up, and we got back to Newcastle about 4:30 in the morning.
We've always looked after our support band.
And we got a day off school.
Sean can tell you that because Sean's band supported us a few times too.
Yeah, we have. Actually, it's always been great. I mean, the great thing about if you get to open for the Angels, the people there really want to rock. They would have a great night.
They do, yeah.
There's no arm-folding pretensions. People are really into it.
Now, I just want to talk a bit about Malcolm Young.
Yeah.
Of course. Were you at his funeral the
other day? Yes, I was. It was very moving, particularly at the end for me, because when Angus walked across to the casket and picked up Mal's guitar, which I'm very familiar with, I was with him when he put the front pickup onto the back position, plugged it into a Marshall and said, "Hey, that sounds pretty good." He's used that guitar ever since.
Wow.
Apparently they're bringing a container load of his guitars to Australia, but that's the guitar he used all the time. But anyway, Angus picked up the guitar and then walked down the aisle with Mal's son and walked back again, looking very forlorn. And as he came back and the casket left the cathedral, there was a pipe band behind, and that brought me undone. And then I got out in the street and there was it was just a pipe ensemble in the cathedral, but outside was a full-on Scottish pipe band with all the drums and everything. And they left the cathedral down the street doing Long Way to the Top. They did some other songs too, but that was the end of me. That was hard because, those guys meant a lot to us. We're good friends. We were there at a number of their recording sessions, including Let There Be Rock, which is like a classic. And there were many of ours as well. We used to hang out together in the studio. We did lots of gigs. We did the Back in Black tour with them. And now, in the last month or so, we've lost both George and Malcolm.
With that, was Malcolm the one who introduced you to Harry Vander?
Well, it was Malcolm and Angus, and I think Bon Scott as well, but Malcolm and Angus are the ones that spoke to us. We did three gigs with them in South Australia, which was Port Pirie, Whyalla and Port Augusta, and we became instant friends. And they saw something in us. So Rick and I, we've always tried to figure out what on earth it was because we were pretty green, trying to learn what we were trying to do. And they were huge influences on us too. I mean, Malcolm's guitar style, I've borrowed a lot from that.
Well, we often talk we have a segment that was actually on Next called the Friday Countdown where we play different lists every week and often they're Australian themed and it just comes up over and over again, the influence of Vander and Young and the Alberts label. Mm-hmm. And we often talk about, don't we, Sean, just what Australian music would be like if they had never existed, if they hadn't curated and encouraged some of the best Australian musicians of the 60s, 70s,
absolutely,
and 80s.
Yeah. I mean, for sure. There's obviously it's a hard question to answer because you don't know, but But, I mean, what they contributed and the inspiration and influence that they had over people like us is huge. And, I mean, to work with George Young, I mean, you know, I would use the expression genius. I mean, he was just amazing. He could inspire you just by talking. And he'd start talking in a rhythm. He'd start making these noises with his mouth, you know, go, like that. You'd walk away going, oh, that's a fantastic idea.
I just have to say there's a great Easy Beats thing that's been showed on,
oh,
shown
the ABC.
On the ABC at the moment.
Yeah, so Friday on My Mind.
It's fantastic. I mean, it's obviously it's reenacting what happened at the time, but there's so little information that has been brought to the mainstream about this band that was so groundbreaking that they went over. They had Friday on My Mind was when I was in America for the first time. We were driving through somewhere in the middle America, and on comes Friday on My Mind. I'm like, they were that big. They were that big.
Yeah, huge.
And they were that great, you know. I mean, I think songs like Black Eyed Bruiser and, of course, Evie, parts 1, 2, and 3, just absolute classics. So they'll never sound dated.
Oh, no. And every time we do, because the countdown has a survey that people answer, anytime Evie's on it. If it's not a top spot, there's only a maybe it's A Long Way to the Top or K-San.
It's blasphemy to play part one without.
Yeah, you've got to play the whole three.
Maybe that won't happen this afternoon.
Time limits.
Of course, John, George and Harry were real mentors to you, weren't they? They kind of, would you say, taught you the art of production? And then they said you guys should actually produce your own records.
Mm. Yeah, they handed over the last track that they produced for us was Coming Down on Me. We put that out as a single, and you know, yet another single that didn't work on radio. And they decided that Rick and I had some good ideas and that we should take over. And initially, when George told that to Rick and me, I kind of felt a bit like, well, you know, they've lost interest. But George wasn't like that. George saw something, and I said, well, how do you produce? And he said, don't worry, we're just down the hall.
Yeah.
So anytime we got stuck for an idea or got into one of those brother arguments, we could go down and have George sort it out for us.
He'd be used to those.
Yeah, especially the brother arguments.
Is it strange for you when you mentioned Coming Down on Me wasn't a big hit, but now your songs are so well loved? You must have seen a lot of work that's not particularly a hit at the time, but then it grows with fondness with, I guess, Dave, when you're singing them.
Oh, yeah, it's huge. Over time, it's huge now, you know. I mean, you know, everyone thinks, Am I Going to See Your Face Again?
Exactly.
It was a huge hit, and it wasn't at all. That was our first single. We were broke for many years after that. But it's huge now.
Well, and like doing Face to Face comes up for its 40th anniversary, you would think that every song on that was a hit single.
Yes.
By the way that the crowd is loves and knows every word of every song. You'd think by hearing them sing it back, oh, they all must have been hit singles, and obviously they weren't.
Well,
it wasn't all singles.
It wasn't all singles, but I've got a story about that because we were so into that album, and I can't remember who it was, and I probably wouldn't name him anyway, but this guy came in who was supposedly an expert, and he said, oh, this music's fantastic. He said, but radio won't play any of this. They played every track.
With me this afternoon on ABC Radio Brisbane and Queensland, from the Angels, John Brewster, Dave Gleeson, and the wonderful Sean Sennett from Time Off Media here as well. The Angels finishing off their latest tour in Brisbane tonight at Eaton's Hill, and then at Night Quarter on the Gold Coast tomorrow night. Sean, you've got the book there on the boys as well.
Yes, that's right, John. I mean, you've got...
You're getting it signed, then you're going to eBay it?
Yes.
Is that what we do?
Well, I wasn't going to say that.
Sorry.
We auction it off. I was going to ask the boys about how they choose the set list, because obviously, Dave, you've sung on a couple of albums of new material. Mm-hmm. You've got that amazing back catalogue. What do you sort of think, John? I mean, do you look at a town where you played 2 years ago and think, what do we play there? How do we change it round?
Not really. No, right. I mean, we always start off with those kind of ideas, and then we settle into a gig, you know, we settle into a set. And the thing is, we try to balance, you know, the big singles along with songs that we know people love that were never singles.
Yeah.
I mean, Marseille, for example, we finished the show with that. It was never a single. It was in America and France and whatever, but not here. But it's a huge song for us. And we do things like Skid Row After Dark, which is one of my personal favourites. I know Dave Loves Be With You. Well, that wasn't a single either, but that's a huge song. So we make sure that they're all in the show, and then a little, left of centre. At the moment, we're doing a few songs from the Skin and Bone album, which is the last album we did with Doc.
I remember that record,
yeah. Yeah, well, it sort of got a bit overlooked at the time, but Rick and I have rediscovered it. Actually, we were sick of it by the time we released it because it took like 5 years to get it.
I was just going to say, just on that whole album, the idea of the album, now it might be getting a little bit more traction again now, but for a while it's just been single. And I think something's been lost in that part in 10 years of music where the album, you haven't been allowed to kind of immerse yourself in the whole of the music from an artist.
Well, I agree with that. I mean, to us, albums like Face to Face and No Exit, Dark Room, etc., they had the singles, they had the recognisable Angels, Nick sort of guitar style, etc. But then you'd go into a song like Outcast, which is a completely different thing, or Dawn is Breaking. And I think if you were just trying to go singles, you'd never even record those songs. But when you listen to them in the context of the album, they're wonderful.
Yeah.
I want to ask Dave, because you're obviously a fan of the Angels first.
Yes.
What songs do you love singing?
Well, Be With You, as John said, that's a real moment. The crowd just, it's one of the lighter moments, softer moments of the Angels, shows another side. So that's always great to do. And Dawn is Breaking, I love it. It's a stream of consciousness from Rick.
Yeah, he's a strange fellow, my brother.
And, as I'm seeing it, like a movie. Like, still to this day, because we've probably only played it. We've only played it on this tour, so it's probably only
I love the
a
way
dozen or 15 times that we've done it. But
Dave does it great, I mean, the lines there, like, if you were born in the barbed wire of your mother's womb, if you were hungry before you died, or at least it's like...
When you say you left your bath all clean and white, I'd know you'd lied, obviously Rick in his early days when he was writing those kind of... There's a real mystery to a lot of the Angels songs as well. Real kind of... There's no real kind of, this is what this song's about. And that's been the other great thing of being in the band is learning the Mondegreens. Mondegreens are the words that I've been singing in my head for many years, and then I find out that's not what it is at all. But also,
did that happen at rehearsal? Like, you're like, wait, Dave, what are you singing?
Well... The thing is that the first time Dave sang with us, which was actually a Brewster Brothers show, it wasn't an Angels show, and he came to the gig because it was in the Adelaide Hills and Dave lives in the Adelaide Hills. He comes up, beer in hand. I said, "Hey, Dave, do you want to get up and sing a couple of songs?" Wow. And he said, "I'd love to." And I said, "Do you know any Angels songs?" He said, "I know them all." So Rick and I put him to the test. And he was right.
There's one that the boys do to finish the show, Love Takes Care of Its Own. And I'm not the only one who always sang, "I've seen you in the movies when I've lived before." It's not that.
Moon mists.
It's in the moon mists when I've lived before.
He's going to hear moon mists.
Exactly. Getting all arty.
Well, Dave has all the lyric down, but I'm still getting him to try and to sing Who Walks on Sheets of Ice for the first of half of the rain.
I've got a tweet here from Dave Brooker who says, "Screaming Jets virtually every second month at the Callum Vale through the 90s, and it was awesome."
Australia's house been there for a while.
Exactly. Now, can I get you guys to play a song for us?
We can. We
love to.
Actually, take a choice. What do you want?
What do you want to do?
After the Rain or No Secrets?
Oh, let's do After the Rain, because we hear No Secrets all the time.
Cool.
What do you reckon?
Okay, well, we've got no Rick here, so you have to just imagine the guitar bits that he does.
When we played this,
we should have had Sean bring his guitar in too.
I could have brought it. It's in the
when
car.
We played this in Paris, it was the song we opened the set with. It was a couple of years ago when we were over there, and immediately that we started it, the whole crowd started chanting like a British football crowd.
You know it's going to be a good gig when that happens.
We all just kind of stopped and looked at each other like, what's going on?
Yeah. Wow. They did that with all the songs.
Amazing.
Including new songs.
Yeah.
In Paris. We hadn't played there for 35 years. We had a full house. They were there at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I mean, about 150 people with all this memorabilia. And I'm looking at them and they're like about 30, 35.
Yeah.
We haven't played there for 35 years. And they were amazing.
They probably conceived at the last Angels gig.
That's right. Pardon me. Thank you. That's all. All right, here we go, John Brewster. Dave
Gleeson. I'll have to hold the guitar up. Right, let's see how we go. 2, 3, 4.
On sheets of ice, who pays for paradise after the rain? After the rain, who suffers fools and freaks, and who hangs in guilty cliques after the rain? After the rain, somebody save me. The water's rising. Sweet Jesus, take the blame. Who knows whose star is falling? After the rain, after the rain. Who took the gold from their teeth? Who changed the ancient masterpiece? After the rain, after the rain. Who throws the winning dice? And who lies beneath the ice? After the rain, after the rain. Somebody save me, the water's rising. Sweet Jesus, take the blame. Who knows whose star is falling? After the rain, after the rain. Somebody save me. Jesus, take the blame. Who knows whose star is falling? After the rain, after the rain. After the rain. After the rain.
Yes. Dave Gleeson, John Brewster from the Angels.
Whistling solos.
Yeah. Well done.
I like it. I like it.
So 40 years next year, the 40th anniversary of Face to Face.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
When you finished the album, were you happy with it?
Oh, we were over the moon.
Yeah.
We lived and breathed the band in those days, you know. Rick and I, we'd do a gig like the Bondi Lifesaver, mm-hmm. and we'd walk off stage at 1 o'clock in the morning and we'd go down to Albert's. We had a key to the studio, so we'd go down there and open up the front door and take the lift up all night. And that wasn't just occasionally, it was like all the time. We used to, things like Rick's guitar solo in Take a Long Line.
Yeah.
You know, that started off with me playing some chords, which are completely different chords to the actual verse, you know, the actual song. And I think it was sort of our classical upbringing. We'd start singing melodies and we could just do it on the guitar, which is probably why the French audience could do them, because they're quite melodic. You know?
And I think that's come full circle now, because yeah. I've met a bunch of young bands doing radio interviews and stuff. And they spend every waking moment, because it's all on their computer, on their laptops now, and that's what they do. They can perfect it without, you know, obviously these guys had access to a studio, but back in the day, if you didn't have access to a studio, you kind of, you did what you could do in the time that you had, and at the end of it, you kind of went, do we remix it? Oh, that's going to cost more money. Yeah. It's gonna... Whereas now, kids can just sit in their bedrooms until they've got it exactly how they want it. Yep. All the plug-in additions to the sound. That's what kids are doing now to make their albums sound great, is what these guys were doing 40 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, we used to have, we'd walk out at about 9 or 10 o'clock in the morning and go across the road because there was a cafe there. So we'd get milkshakes, Kit Kats, finger buns, etc. Never put a pound on.
Those were the days, my friend.
Yeah.
The other thing is the pubs of the day. Like we just like there are some great venues around, but the pubs back then, you know, did they determine the music? I know you've written on the Angels website you were looking forward to some of these gigs because they had, you know, you had the sticky carpets and the close quarters. And how much did that determine? And even for you, Dave, as well, before you joined the Angels, and that. You know, it was sticky, it was sweaty, the carpets were foul, and you had the best time ever.
Yeah, well, you did, and of course everyone smoked, so you were in the most unhealthy environment imaginable, and also dangerous environment, because back in the late 70s, I mean, there were no fire restrictions, there were all those rules that came in. We probably caused a lot of those rules to come in, because it was... I mean, we got away with it. Everyone got away with it, but it was incredibly dangerous, really. Mm. Like the stage door, we put 1,956 payers in. I reckon it was licensed for 400 people.
Yeah.
And to get to the stage from the dressing room, which wasn't that far, it took something like 15 minutes because you had to actually squeeze between people. With holding the guitar aloft so it didn't go out of tune.
I remember the first smoke-free tour that I can recall is Jenny Morris in about 1992, and I think she said, "That's it, I'm not doing it." And we're all like, "Yeah, as if that's going to happen." And she forged a path. I mean, even Joey McKean, Slim Dusty's wife, she says the fact that he played in so many smoky rooms actually attributed to his demise later on in life. So, Jenny was a bit of a trailblazer.
You're right. I remember when she initiated that, people couldn't believe she was doing it. It's a great thing.
It was. It certainly changed the vibe for, you know, you do a two-hour show with other people's smoke. It's terrible.
Yeah. I was going to ask you about your new music. How do you guys write now? You live in different parts of Australia. How's the process work these days?
Yeah, that's a good question. For me, I tend to doodle on the guitar, walk around the house with an acoustic guitar and come up with riffs and stuff. And then when we get into the studio, Rick will say, "Have you got any ideas?" And I go, "Oh, I've got this one." And sometimes 20 minutes later, we've got an actual recording of it that's actually a keeper.
Yeah.
And Rick's much more applied. He takes the whole thing, you know, it'll take 3 weeks and come up with something really great too. But what we're doing these days is really encouraging Dave to write with us.
Yeah.
And he's written a number of songs now. We'll give him a rhythm track.
Yeah.
And just say, "See what you come back with." And he comes back 6 days later with, you know, half a dozen songs that are fantastic. He's a great lyricist. I really love his lyric.
Mm.
The same goes for Nick Norton, our drummer, who's an amazing singer-songwriter in his own right.
Mm.
And he comes up with great ideas too, and so does my son Sam. So we encourage everybody, and somehow it all works. You know, it doesn't sound like, you know, five different ideas. There's a thread going through it. So, yeah, really happy. I mean, it's a very happy camp, actually. It's funny because we've got two guys in the band at mid-30s. Dave's sort of mid to late 40s.
Somewhere in there, I would say,
I'm mid to late 60s. Rick's right in the middle. And it's funny because it's three different generations in the same band. It's really, very, a really happy camp.
Yeah. Well, two shows left of this tour. How's it been?
It's been amazing. We've done a lot of theatres, like the Enmore Theatre in Sydney, which is an incredible venue, and the Palms at Crown Casino. We did two nights there. It's a magnificent venue. So we've done a lot of those kind of shows. We've had Rose Tattoo with us. Diesel did the Enmore with us. People who have meant something to our history, because it kind of ties to the book a bit, you know. And, you know, Rose Tattoo were in Albert's in those wonderful days. And My Sex, they're fantastic.
Yep. And they're supporting tonight and tomorrow night?
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah. Steve Balby's singing with them. And
he's a freak. He's unreal.
He's just
stepped
fantastic.
Stepped out from the bass from Noiseworks.
And you realise just how many great songs they've got, you know. Yeah. So all these bands that have been with us have history with us.
Yeah.
And speaking of history, one story about staying up in the studio all night, I'm walking around 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm walking down the corridor. I bumped into Harry Vander, and Harry said, "Oh, Johnny, you got a minute?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "I think we might have a song." So he takes me down to Studio 3, which is like a converted legal office, and there's this tape going right around the room, and that tape was the drum track, and they hit the play button, and it was "Lovers in the Air."
Oh, great story.
I nearly fell over.
We're going to have to leave it there, but thank you so much for coming in tonight at Eden's Hill Hotel, tomorrow night on the Gold Coast at Night Quarter. The Angels with My Sex and Rose Tattoo. Thanks again, John Brewster, Dave Gleeson.
Thank you.
Kelly, great pleasure to talk to you, and you too, of course, Sean.
Good to chat to you, boys.
Talk to you after two, Sean.
Terrific.